Welcome back, Spin TV. We are checking out the final round of the 2014 Texas States NT. This is the second half. Again, I'm Jamie Thomas, joined once again by Simon Lazat. We're going to start on hole 11. It's about 261 feet to the pin, and there's about a 30-foot ring right around. You basically need to throw it inside the circle. Rick Wysocki is on the box, and he's actually going to lay up right in the safe zone, right out. It's a pitch over, and take the three. He's pretty confident in the lead at this point. And then we have the man. Simon says, no fear, lining up the big forehand and swinging right in nicely over the trees. Was that something that you saw immediately and wanted to go for when he laid up on that?
Well, if you watch the small flags there in the fairway, we had a massive headwind on that little hole, and that sidearm was a risky shot. But I didn't really have anything to lose, so I'd try it for sure.
And you can see these next two players right here are also going to try sidearms with drastically different results. Paul Ulibarri goes out a little early, and Macbeth gets caught up in the headwind as he hits his forehand a little flatter. Here's Uli throwing for three. And this is a nice correction right here. Hangs it out wide, keeps it hyzer, gets a nice little skip in for the pin for a drop in four. And Macbeth's going to go for the sidearm once again. And he's looking like he's coming in hot, but world champ Love, we'll call it, drops right out of the tree. He's going to look at a putt for four as well. So here's Ricky. He's laid up just nicely, plays the sidearm. And it's very interesting to see, you know, in practice rounds, some of the pros would actually take the backhand approach. Was the headwind the reason that that didn't happen on the final round?
I don't know. Just seeing these downhanging branches to the left right now of the basket, it made the hyzer real tough, and I don't think in that wind it was easy to predict what was going to happen, so the sidearm was just the more open shot.
That's really good insight right there, and as Paul just donks one, something that'll probably haunt him, and think about that on the drive home. Simon has no problem tapping it right over in the wind, and we're going to have Paul for a five. An unfortunate five after he had just taken a seven on that hole, and this is where you really test that mental game and find out what you're made of in order to come back from that. Next hole, we have hole 12. This is a 231-foot uphill shot. For the most part, it's pretty routine, but then again, this weekend, nothing was routine in this wind. I have to apologize, we actually missed Simon's drive. Dave Feldberg was hidden by the gallery that was watching this crew, and actually had a pitch over on hole 14, so we had to move out of the way and ended up missing some of the drives on this. But Simon, really nice drive here. Tell us what you did.
Yeah, the wind wasn't too bad for us here. We had like a tail crosswind from the left, and it's probably the easiest hole, arguably, that one, and I took my Firebird and totally parked it.
And as you can see, the tailwind is pushing the hyzer, and it's pretty routine for these guys. Everybody's landing within the circle and giving themselves a look at birdie. Paul's going to follow suit with a backhand and throw it nice and going to curl up right by the pin. There's no easier putt than that, especially in this wind. That's what you want to look for. So Ricky's looking at a slight downhill putt with a strong tailwind. It's important just to keep this high enough and into the chains, and he does that. Really nice shot right there. He was going to follow suit and get his, and we're going to end up with a star frame. And that's a big question. When you're trying to push and take control, make a run, is it frustrating to see everybody kind of get that birdie after you parked that hole so nicely?
It's just great to see that great golf, and Ricky's putt right there was a great demonstration on why he won that tournament, just clutch putting all week.
Hole 13. 409 feet, slightly downhill. This is a hole that a lot of different lines are taken depending on the wind. You see the intermediate hyzer, which was actually the first time I saw somebody throw that route when you did right here. And a lot of people take the outside window. Some people even pipe one straight down at it. Ricky's going to take a slightly bigger hyzer approach over here, and his is actually going to leave out to the right a little bit on the wrong side of the basket, looking at a big old headwind putt coming back. And you're gonna see Ulibarri take the straight line throw, and this is nice. Throw something nice and stable, get a little skip. He's gonna leave himself on the headwind side of the basket, which is the side you wanna err on, and try to make a run back. Macbeth looks like one of his rock threes, and he just leaves it with enough height. And most of the time, you don't 409 feet. You don't think rock three. Why would he go with a mid-range here?
I was very surprised by him throwing a mid-range in that wind. And as you could see, the disc fought that wind the entire way, trying to carry left, and just the wind from the left was just... It was really tough wind for us.
Ulibarri's going to have the other side of the basket, a slight cross just off the top. And Paul Macbeth, this is a putt you really want to get, especially after you throw a really nice finesse shot with that mid-range, but... As you can see, the flag on the top of the basket, the wind is just whipping left to right on him. And he's going to leave it short, unfortunately short. And what's going through your mind when a wind is going from left to right in this situation?
All of what is in my mind that moment is get it in that basket, no matter how. Just throw it and hope it stays in, and luckily it did.
And your heart skips a beat a little bit when you see it jump up like that. Ricky's going to tap in, almost kick out the backside, but hangs on to that last chain. Paul's going to grab a three as well. And Paul Ulibarri will also take a three on this hole. As we go on to the corner, 13A. This hole is tricky for a number of different reasons. First of all, it's 400 feet. You're teeing off into a nice narrow window. You've got rocks on the backside of the tee pad that limit your run-up. And you've got out-of-bounds playing the whole right side down of the fairway. As we're going to see this angle from above the basket, this is a big aggressive shot you threw right here.
Yeah, I was a little mad at myself after that because it totally changed my game plan. I just had three birdies in a row, was feeling good, gained 8 strokes on Macbeth in 4 holes. And I went for it. I just should have played it safe, so that was not a good choice.
And unfortunately, you did have to pay for it as it dropped down into the lake. And you're going to see Ricky's going to throw a much safer hyzer line down into the main little valley and give himself nice up and down for 3 opportunity. Ulibarri's going to take the Anheuser route, throw a nice smooth one, but leaves himself with a pretty tough look for 2, more likely a 3. Paul Macbeth's going to do the same thing. It looks like he reads the wind off Ulibarri's shot here and throws it higher, lets it hang out and get that extra distance, get closer to the big rock pile, which is probably about 60, 70 feet from the pin. So they give you the mark right here. Are you throwing it in, or are you looking to lay up?
I totally wanted to lay up, but in that wind, we had a massive headwind. Any shot is tough in that wind, and I was just trying to get it close to get a tap in if possible.
As Paul Macbeth approaches his lie, is it different for each player, or what do you look for? If you have a basket on an incline or on a slope, do you want to be above the basket or below the basket?
I personally like putting uphill, so I like to be short of it. It depends on what you prefer, I guess.
I'd imagine that has a lot to do with the player's putting style as well. Ricky's going to make a nice run at it, but leaves it a little strong side. And for the most part, these should be pretty routine tap-ins. Paul's going to grab his. Paul Macbeth, that is. Ulibarri, from pretty much the same spot, is going to grab one as well. And from the uphill lie into a wind, got to get it down in the cage. And what happened on that putt?
I don't know, just lost concentration for a second, and that was nothing I wanted to do right there.
You can definitely see as you jogged it out real quick to kind of regain composure and come back to this hole. This next hole, 13B, is a really big birdie opportunity, casually called the pyramid. 275 feet, you're just throwing over the little undulation in the fairway. It's about 50 feet right of the pin is out of bounds, so you've got to make sure that if you throw that hyzer that it gets back in bounds and you don't turn it over. Wasaki's got the box first, and he actually saws it off. I think he was trying to play a little bit too safe in the wind and leaves himself a really long look, opening the door for some of these other guys to gain a stroke right back. Ulibarri is going to correct off this throw, challenge the out-of-bounds line, a nice little skip, and a good look at 2 there. Now, Paul takes an interesting route here in this wind. He's going to what looks like his Nova throw a more or less straight shot. but in the tailwind, doesn't leave it quite high enough to get to the basket, and going to have a really long look. Simon lines up the backhand hyzer right here. Nice and high. No doubt it's inbounds. Curls right around the pyramid. That's textbook for that wind and that look right there. Ricky's lining up a tough shot, especially after the last two shots have curled so close to the pin. He really wants to at least get this one close. And he saws this one off again. And that way it's a right-to-left cross, so it's pushing the putter fade side, and he's going to have a headwind putt coming right back at it. He's just below the pin up on the embankment, but this, again, like you said earlier, Simon, that's why he won this tournament. That's just a fantastic putt right there.
Yeah, this shows so well how putting demands this game. You can have two bad shots and make a putt and still get a par, and we had good drives, missed our putt, and got the same score. So it's all about making those putts.
Definitely a crucial moment. Tell us a little bit about what are you telling yourself in your mind right now? You've had two hit the same part. You've hit the chastity band up top. You know, how do you correct that? Do you correct that during the round, or do you just keep playing?
I don't know. When I miss high, I definitely rather miss high than I miss low. So I gave it a chance. And in that wind, really, it's, I don't expect to make that putts. It's great if they go in, but it's not a must.
Hole 14, we have 411 feet, and there was a strong right-to-left crosswind that's pushing the fade. So the out-of-bounds line actually goes along the ridgeline here, so the guys have to make sure that they leave it high enough so that the wind pushing the fade doesn't slam them down into the hillside and cause them to not come back in bounds, as we'd seen happen earlier on a few other of the cards. And you can see both Ricky and Ulibarri there get nice and high up into the tree, stop short a little bit, but still safe in bounds. Paul throws his a little bit wider, clears past the tree. He's going to be short and definitely in the fairway, and going to have a tough headwind look. And again, Simon, he was ready to get on that tee box right after missing that putt, because we actually missed his drive and we were following Macbeth's to the ground. And pretty routine layups. This fairway's pretty flat and straight. You just want to get up and down for three if you don't have a look, right?
Yeah, that pin position especially was probably the windiest part of the course for that day. And Paul's laying up a little long, and that wind, it's so tough. And here's one of my three jump putts with a Firebird that round. So that just shows all it takes for that one was an overstable disc to get to the basket.
Definitely want to play an air on the side of using a more overstable disc in order to keep the wind from catching it and carrying it towards the out of bounds right there. So nobody's going to gain a stroke on Ricky in the last two holes. And you're running out of holes here. You know, are you playing for second at this point? Are you still trying to make a move and catch him? What's your game plan?
My game plan is to stay second at that point.
It's tough when he gets such a big lead and he's putting so well. Hole 15, 295 feet. You're going to play again just over the undulation down into the bowl, and there's a out of bounds to the right of the pin. You want to keep it on hyzer, especially in a slight header cross, and Ricky does a very nice just textbook job there. Ulibarri is going to do the same thing. His is going to hyzer out a little bit early. I think he just didn't quite put enough power on it. Maybe babied it just a little bit too much. And Paul getting lined up. Really, he throws a little bit of a flatter, higher line here. But unfortunately, he gets caught up in the wind still and going to leave himself a tough look. And this is your Firebird right here, right?
Yeah, Firebird was like 50% of my tee shots. It was so windy, you just had to throw that. And off the tee, I thought it was perfect. And when I walked up there, I saw it was like a good 20 feet short. It's not what I wanted.
Very tough to throw downhill into this bowl, but keep it from going up over the ridge where the camera is and keep it in bounds. That's a fantastic putt by Paul right there. That's sheer guts and sheer force of will putting the disc into that basket at this point. Simon's lining up and the wind is pushing, picking the disc up and just taking it right over. Yeah. Here's another one of these putts on a different kind of basket. How odd is that to play around when you have different kinds of baskets?
Oh, it didn't really affect me at all. But see how I just slammed that? It was so tough just slamming it and trying and hope that it sticks.
And definitely a different look than the two that you missed off the top earlier. Put it in with more authority. They have a couple more drop-ins. So Macbeth will take the two. Ricky will take the two. Simon and Paul Ulibarri with the par. Here's a really fun hole coming up. Hole 16, the second island hole. Actually throwing over water. We are looking at 325 feet from the tee to the pin. The last tree before the front side of the island is about 240 feet. So you've got about a 60-foot gap. You can air 60 feet short of the pin and still be looking at the three. Ricky's gonna throw the forehand and fortunately leaves it high, tight, and just never gets inside. So you're not allowed to take a mark on this island hole. You do have to go to the drop zone if you don't stay in bounds. Paul throws it wider and plants one. That's a good safe shot right there. Doesn't challenge the pin too hard. Just get it in bounds and look at the three. Ulibarri opts for the backhand and in the wind just pushes it out and keeps it from fading in. And so Simon, with an opportunity, the door open, challenges that midline tree, splits the gap with a beautiful little skip. And you can hear the gallery right there cheering for him as he kept it in bounds. I'm sure that was a big sigh of relief right there.
I felt really lucky after that one. Just watching Paul miss to the right, it just probably made me mentally think, release it early, and I kind of slipped and it just stayed in bounds. I was feeling lucky for sure.
Ulibarri and Ricky both have to go to the drop zone. Ricky puts one in. Yuli's going to take the same forehand style approach, and they're just going to try to limit the damage and get out of there at this point. Paul's got a long look, and you can tell by his body language that he's lining up and wants to hit this. He makes a run, unfortunately takes pin, but leaves it too short, and I think he's figuring out definitely at that point that it's going to be tough to catch you and really make that move back to second. As Simon's going to lay up there. Ricky probably wanted that stroke back if the tournament was closer, but at this point he's got a pretty sizable lead and it's really tough to make up strokes with two holes left. There's going to be some tap-ins, and one of the crew kind of forgot to tap in here.
Right, you see my disc, it's right under the basket, and I actually went to the next tee forgetting about my disc there, and I got to give Paul Macbeth credit for stepping up to me and telling me I got to finish that hole, because I was so ready to get finished with that round, with the tournament, that I just forgot about tapping in.
So luckily Simon does properly go back and tap in within time, and everything is good as far as that went to finish up hole 16. So hole 17 is the big monster. This is where the guys get to really show off their arms and try to make a move. And this is a hole that separated you from a lot of other people in this tournament. We have 1,003 feet, and you eagled it twice in the other two rounds?
No, in the first round I had a tap and eagle, and the second round I got a four. A four is still a good score on that hole, but as you see right here, this is not what I wanted to do. I saw right away when I released, that's going in the water. I saw that happen in practice to someone else, and that was just a mistake. Threw it too low.
Like he said, he called it right out of his hand, knew it was rolling. Yuli is going to correct off this and throw a little bit higher, and just beautiful shot, dead center fairway. That's exactly how it's done. He jokes around and says he only threw 250 feet. And here's Ricky throwing same disc he's been throwing pretty much all day. Just throwing it really high, playing the wind, and leaving it high enough to ride out and get some good distance on it there. So when you mark your lie here, what's your thought process? Are you looking to safely get out right wide and pitch over, or are you playing an aggressive shot?
No, an aggressive shot was not an option there because it was so muddy and I was just focusing on not slamming my face in the mud at that point. Trying to get it as far as possible, obviously, but I was trying to get a five if possible. I knew five would be my best score.
And we had mentioned it in the first half of the round commentary, but especially by this point, the temperature dropping rapidly And by the time this round ended, it was just cold. In addition to the wind, you know, grip becomes a factor, especially when you have to throw these big monster holes, and being able to consistently grip the disc and place it that far down the fairway does become an issue. We do have Macbeth here. He's going to try. He's going to sort of make the same mistake you did. He had a little more height on it that time, but brings it over hard on the Annie, and he's going to not really get the result he was looking for there. This is a tough lie. You went from tough lie to tough lie on this hole.
Yeah, the branch is totally in my run-up. And, yeah, what you're going to do if you can't run up correctly, it's all in your arm swing, and couldn't get it there.
And it's still not too bad. Leaving yourself wide enough to look at the pin. Yuli's throwing another great hyzer here, but just gets an unfortunate skip. You know, you were looking at it and expecting it to get a nice flare. Ricky is going to saw this one off, and it's actually going to go towards the water. We lose this one with the camera a little bit, but he is going to be safe, but not by much. Paul, probably, and that's what we were talking about with the grip, the cold grip. You're going to hang on to it a little more as he grip locks it a little bit, hits the tree, and it's going to take a penalty stroke there being in the water. And this is just a layup, get up and down, go to the next hole.
I couldn't feel my hand at that point. It was so cold, just trying to get it over with.
And you could tell even by the time the awards had started, you know, people were hanging out in their cars and waiting, or had even taken off. And that's just, it's an unfortunate ending to what was a really, really tough tournament in terms of the weather and not getting a larger spectator gallery. But this round was a huge battle, and everybody had their ups and downs, but really battled very hard to try to bring this championship home. Some higher scores on this one. Ricky and Uleberry are both going to par, and Simon and Macbeth are going to take bogeys here. As we go on to the last hole, 301 feet, we're going to go uphill a little bit. Very interesting to note, on this last hole coming up, there were cars parked in just out of bounds or even in the fairway at some point that multiple players were using as backboards. Got to give Drew Gibson from Orangevale a shout out. He decided to use one of those cars and absolutely just parked this hole for a drop-in birdie. And, you know, unfortunately, some of those people didn't get that advantage, but what can you do about that? Uleberry's going to hang a nice high hyzer out there. And tell us a little bit about the wind on this hole, because it changed throughout the weekend, and how does it affect your shot here?
I mean, this hole is slightly uphill, and it's only 300 feet, and it was totally unreachable for us because we had the massive headwind, and we're just crushing our drives up there and still being like 60, 70 feet short. And yeah, it's a simple par, and at this point.
At this point, you just don't want to take extra numbers. You want to secure your position. You're holding on to a strong second, and you just don't want to give anybody from the chase card or the third card a chance to jump up and, you know, possibly take that spot.
Jump putt Firebird right there again.
Another jump putt Firebird into that strong header cross wind. Ricky's going to lay up so he can get the ceremonial last putt to claim this victory. Paul's going to run this. And it looked like he only took a halfway run at it. And that headwind just picked it up and almost actually slammed it in for him as he just glanced off the cage. And everybody here is going to take their par and give Ricky the final putt for his victory. And this was a really, really tough tournament. Ricky putted so well, and that 55 in the first round just proved to be not overcomable by any of the other competitors. But we do have to note that 53, hot round of the weekend. Simon, you played phenomenally, you know, a great showing in the second NT of the year. What are your plans from here? How do you approach the next one?
I mean, my first national tour at the Memorials, I finished in seventh, which I thought was pretty awesome. Next national tour, I got second place, which is way over my expectations, and I loved every moment, and I hope it goes on from here, and maybe I can get a first win someday.
What would it be like having gone toe-to-toe with them before and stayed on the lead card? Does that change your mentality when battling against guys like Paul and guys like Ricky?
Being on a league card and playing against these world-class players, it always will change your mentality, it always will change your game plan. I don't know, maybe it was a good thing I got put on second card for the second round, but I just enjoy playing with those guys and I enjoy having a gallery. I just love playing for show.
Well, thank you very much for joining us for this commentary. Your insight is very helpful. Spin TV family, I hope you guys found it as interesting as I did. Please subscribe. Thank you for all the support you've given us so far. So until next time, for Simon Lizotte, I'm Jamie Thomas, and we'll talk to you guys soon.